First of all, I should thank IABF and Cyber Society MNA for inviting me to share our thoughts on this. We all know it's a very important subject, critical subject, I would say. I wouldn't miss this for anything else. But at the same time, because of constraint of time, I will not probably go into every slide that we have. But I'll try to give a sense of what the compliance with the regulatory framework that is in place. And what kind of issues that we are seeing in the system, especially from the bank's point of view. Obviously, the participants are very active here. That's very nice to know. But only thing is, we don't have that much time to interact and just even regulators also. We need to also understand what's happening in the system. And this is a kind of two-way feedback that always helps. Within the constraints of time that we have, we'll try to make best use of that. Now, what I will do is, I'll spend a few minutes and just explaining how the for banks it's a very critical risk, and then I'll move to very briefly also give a sense of what is the framework that we have over a period of time, and currently what is happening, and also the IT examinations that we do, we have started doing for the last 1 year or so, what is the sense that we are getting from the banks. So that also I'll try to share with you. Use to you, and then recently whatever we have been doing, so that also I'll try to touch upon. So banking is a business risk, right? Basically, essentially banking is a business risk, and the risk, without taking risk there can't be any banking. And normally when we talk about risk is taken because there are returns. That is the reason why risks are taken. So we have fundamentally something called credit risk, where you give the money and the risk of not getting it back. And we have market risk, where you have the value of your holdings, investments can undergo change. And we have something called liquidity risk, where the bank may run out of liquidity in terms of meeting its commitments. These are all the basic banking business risks. But we have something called operational risk, which is the risk of not doing anything properly. So that is all pervasive. I mean, anything that a bank does or any organization does for that matter, there is operational risk involved in that. So, but at the same time, can we say that by taking more operational risk, we can have more returns, like credit risk for that matter? If you take more credit risk, you get more returns. Though there could be more losses down the line, but at least initially there could be returns. Same thing with market risk. But operational risk, is it? You may not find a clear correlation that way. And IT risk definitely is a part of operational risk, in the sense that, I mean, you take more IT risk, definitely there will be more losses, but there is no linkage to returns. So if you save on security expenses, let us say, I mean, we know that internationally, globally, international active banks, they spend up to 15% of their IT budget on security. But how much that our banks are spending? It's minuscule. The IT budgets itself are small. And within them, security budgets are much more minuscule. So that is the kind of situation. But the question is, we have to follow the proportionality principle. Is it really required to spend so much for IT or cyber security? So that is where I am coming from. We could have financial losses because of cyber security or IT risk, and we could have non-financial losses. Financial losses is easy to understand, but non-financial, there could be reputational risk, because you are not handling your systems properly, and supposing they are hacked, and there are losses, the customer, you may lose the customers. So there is a strategic risk, because you have lost the customer, and you inadequately, if you are not maintaining your systems, you will have problems there. So there is a risk of losing business, there is a risk of losing the customers, and also the reputation can suffer, and for a bank, reputation is the key. And if a bank loses reputation, I mean, that is very difficult to continue in the business. We all know the examples in this area. Then legal and compliance risks. So if you don't follow the law of the land, cyber laws, then you are in trouble. And if you don't comply with the regulators' requirements, the guidelines, then you are exposed to punitive action from regulator. Then, as I said, it's these kind of risks are not, you know, not that they affect only one part of the bank's functioning, or they'll only result in some kind of financial loss or non-financial loss. But sometimes, depending on the severity of the incident of the cyber security. Sometimes it can even affect the viability of the bank itself, and also can lead to its failure. And nowadays, as we know, the networking principle operates, and banks do not operate in silos. And if one bank fails, there could be sedimentary issue, there could be technological issue, and there could be simple kind of settlement issue. Settlement risk can happen, and with that, one bank failure can lead to multiple bank failure, and it can lead to the whole financial instability issues. So some even have prophesized in a worse way that next global financial crisis can happen, rather can be triggered by a significant cybersecurity incident. I mean, that is not too far-fetched to imagine that. It can happen. So with this kind of understanding that how crucial the IT risk and IT cybersecurity, we can do now is to look at the regulation, how it has evolved over a period of time. As we all know, Gopal Krishna Committee report was in 2011, and based on that we had issued a circular. It is a very comprehensive report. Any of you, definitely some of you might have had opportunity to look at it. It's a very comprehensive report, and it also said that this is not the be all and end all. I mean, the banks need to go beyond this and be flexible and be proactive in looking at the kind of threats and issues that are coming up, and accordingly modify their systems. So this report talked about everything about IT governance, information security, operations, outsourcing, IS audit, cyber frauds, BCP, etc. Banks have been implementing it, and there could be some areas where the bank's implementation was not up to the mark, and we, as a part of our regular supervisory framework, we keep noticing them, and we tell the banks to make improvements in those areas. Now, this is the latest thing. In last June 2nd, 2016, we have come up with this cybersecurity framework circular, and some of you might have seen it. The reason why we have come out with this is that I wouldn't say it's very timely. It should have been placed quite earlier, but again, these kind of things take time, and we felt a need to have this kind of proactive regulation in place, so that because we also have seen a slew of incidents happening across the sector, requiring better realization from the banks, that banks have to be one up on the incidents that are happening. So what it essentially says is that, I will not read out the whole slide, but essentially what it says is that the board's involvement is what is required here. These are the key approaches to the whole cybersecurity framework regulation. What we want is that the board has to be involved more, and in our assessments, what we have seen is that there is one member of the board who is kind of familiar with the IT, and sometimes they are from IT industry itself. But again, among the other members of the board, and also in the CEO, they may not be the required level of appreciation about the cybersecurity and its importance. This is what we have understood. Why it's required is that, now we could really see any product that the bank wants to introduce, any product or any process it wants to introduce, right? Or it wants to have this particular function defined in its organization and wants to equip with the staff or the technology, you cannot wish away the aspect of IT or cyber security. We have seen how the products, some of the products are designed, especially the digital products, and you can understand what kind of involvement is required, where you need to marry the requirements of business with the security considerations. And we have seen that in some of the banks, especially private sector banks, the cost saving is the most, the overriding factor, and customer convenience again is the overriding factor. So because these three are the different mutually exclusive kind of parameters. You have more customer convenience, then you have to dilute the security, right? And you have more security, it will inconvenience the customer, and then the more security you won't have, the more cost it is. So these are the three mutually exclusive factors they need to really balance while designing the product. And we have seen that essentially in private sector banks, the intention is always to cut down on the cost and also give the more convenience to the customer. So that, because it's a issue of competition, if your competitor is giving a better product which gives a more convenience and we can do a few more simple steps, but you want to introduce so many security steps, obviously the customer will opt your competitor. So obviously with these kind of three competing factors that they have, and we find that in private sector bank that kind of inclination is there, but in public sector banks it's a different issue altogether. Yes, cost may not be that factor relatively, and convenience generally is not looked at. So these are the issues when you compare that. So these kind of, when the issues are coming up in every product introduction or process introduction, you need to know what technology is being used, how much business it is generating, or you know what kind of security budgets are required in that. If the right appreciation is required in all these things, in a board consisting of so many people with from different specializations and expertise, and if they don't have a common understanding of this IT risk and cyber security, then there is a possibility that the board would be relying on the technical teams and taking decisions without fully understanding the risks. So with that, when it really happens, when there is some incident happens, some risk gets elevated, then the board will really find it difficult to respond in a right way. So that is why we want that, let there be expertise at the board level, let there be understanding. So then how it comes, because we all know how technical it is, the entire the cyber security area is, how technical it is. But the point is, how do you really ensure that this jargon or this technical issues are reduced or translated into something more simpler and easy to understand at board of directors level? And how do you see that they take the right decisions? So that requires translation of your technical requirements into business kind of understandable language, so that the board can take a call on that. So this entire circular focuses on that the board should be more involved in the entire aspect of cyber security. That's why it says it has to have a separate policy. Then we also talk about the cyber crisis management plan. Right, like we have the way IT function is organized in banks, sometimes is an issue also. For example, in public sector banks, we have an IT department. They take care of everything. But other department, do they have an understanding or appreciation of what IT department is doing? No. In private sector banks, some of them, they have experimented with an organization like every vertical will have an IT support group within them. So there is no separate IT department, but there is, like for example, retail banking. There is a retail banking technology group. There is a wholesale banking technology group, like that. So each, the technology is a part of business. Are you getting me? Technology is a part of business. So, but what are the dangers with that? The danger is it's too scattered and distributed. There is no convergent IT function. So there is no chief IT officer or CAO or anybody like that. So then what happens in terms of crisis? You have BCPs for various critical applications, but do you have a plan which immediately swings into action based on some kind of document, based on a team that swings into action, or a single person or a team of people who take leadership and ensure that quickly the crisis is attended to? It may not be there. So that's where this comes, this direction comes from RBA, where it says that you need to have a plan which is approved by board, and where it should address the following very key aspects, four aspects. One is detection. That is very important. As somebody said, there are two types of organization, those who are hacked and those who are hacked but they are not aware. And somebody said there are three categories. One is those who are hacked and those who are hacked but not aware. Third is those who are going to be hacked. So essentially everybody is going to be hacked. So that is the point. So basically there are three types which covers everybody, every organization. So detection, that way, is a key. It may be happening, it might have happened earlier, but if you don't detect, then there's no point. Then response, how do you respond to it? Recovery, and then containment. You have a clear plan for all these four stages, then your crisis management can work. So there is a detailed circular. I'll not go too much detail. I'll just touch upon few small things. Then the second issue is reporting. We all know what has happened in that Hitachi Payment Services, that issue, that 3.2 million debit cards. There are reporting issues. Banks don't, earlier also, the IB card, we have the system under IDRBT, but banks are rather hesitant to report fully the requirements, that whatever happened, the incident issues. So that is something we want to tighten and see that the banks report promptly, and so that is something which this circular also lays a lot of emphasis on. Then it also talks about gap assessment based on this wherever whatever requirement we are given, and they need to and the another important thing is the SOC, that security operations center. Some of the banks have got very state of the art SOCs, but some of them may have slightly less inferior, or some may not have at all. So we want that everybody should have a SOC in place. And so quickly, if other things that the circular aims at is the proportionality. I mean, see, it's not that everybody should have the state of art best data center or best SOC in the, it's not required. Depending on their exposures, depending on their technology use, depending on their size, complexity of business and all that, they can have the proportionate systems. The main thing is, again, proactive, preventive engagement rather than reactive. What happens now is only reactive systems. Then adaptive incident response, that is another the keyword that we lay emphasis on. And finally, alignment of business needs with security controls, that is another important thing. Now, this, having understood the importance of IT risks in banking organizations and also the regulatory framework that we have put in place, from last year we have started looking at these banks. And we have started conducting IT examinations. I also done some major private sector banks and public sector banks. So some of the understanding takeaways from that I'll share with you. I'll not go in all details, but essentially one is IT governance. Though there are committees, though there are some board member who's having IT expertise and all that, essentially the oversight of the entire IT function is not up to the mark, at least most of the banks. That is what we have understood. So they need for more board involvement and top management involvement. And we have, you know, even public sector banks, we have the GM IT who may not have any qualification about IT, unfortunately. And some of the banks, we had CISO without any CISA qualification, or like a GM inspection of a bank is the CISO of the bank. That is not something acceptable. So we have told them to appoint a proper CISO. It is not something acceptable. So our CISO is there, is a chief manager or AGM, in the scheme of the bank's things, maybe he is not empowered. But CISO has to be empowered. If he is not empowered, then he will not be able to, you know, have the voice to flag the issues which require immediate, top management response. So that is not happening, then that is a serious issue. Then IT skills, of course, this is a major issue. And we have in some of the public sector banks, lots and lots of in-house development of software. But at the same time, lots and lots of dependence on the vendors also for developing applications. How both can go together? I mean, it doesn't happen like that. I mean, either you optimally you use the outsiders for your development, software development, or at least you be self sufficient, to which is very difficult to have your own in-house thing and maintain it. We have an example here, IOB. I think some of the people are here in IOB. So I'm not taking it in a negative sense, but they had wonderful CBS system crown for more than 10 years. It was a kind of showpiece among all the banks, and but it's very difficult to maintain, that kind of system purely with the insiders. It's very tough. So that's why the bank had to go to Pinnacle. So that's, I mean, it's a positive thing at that point of time, but later on, I mean, it may not be positive. So that's just an example. Again, legacy issues and all, you are aware. Then the security issues, I'll not get into too much detail here. There are issues there, SOC, vendor dependence and all that are there. Then we are setting up of one subsidiary, the Reserve Bank Information Technology Limited. Now it's coming up, and we have appointed CEO, and they have recruited some specialists. And that will have tremendous brief in terms of helping, assisting the sector, banking sector per se. And it's a focus, with a focus on IT and cyber security in financial sector, including research they do. Then it will assist in IT systems audit and assessment of RBI regulated entities. I mean, all the banks and major NBFCs and all that. And it will advise, implement and manage internal or system-wide IT projects of RBI. Because you know that we are, we have over the years implemented huge projects like, RTGS. And even our CBS, internal CBS within RBI, we call it eKuber. That is a real showpiece as far as central banks are concerned, many of the central banks have shown interest in how we have designed our CBS, and they are kind of taking leaf after that. Then regarding SWIFT, we all know what has happened to Bank of Bangladesh, and we are aware of that. So obviously we wanted that, and also we have seen that in our banks there have been cases, frauds, misusing the SWIFT mechanism for especially in trade finance, in LCs and issuing letter of comforts and all that. We found that there has been major frauds in some of the banks. So there we have, what we did is we did a survey of all the banks in terms of how they have organized their entire SWIFT function and what are the controls that are in place. And we found that there are a lot of gaps, and the banks are vulnerable. So accordingly, these surveys results, the observations, we have shared with all the banks, and we have told them that they should tighten the controls in this area, because this is an area which can, because one of the public sector banks were almost very close to losing a huge amount of money. But luckily, the correspondent bank checked, and that's how they were saved from the, you know, like the ignominy, like what Bank of Bangladesh had to endure. So our banks are vulnerable in this area, and we are also quite seriously concerned with that, and things are improving there. A lot of the banks have started working on that, and lot of banks have put in a lot of security controls. So that is something that we are also very serious about. Then setting up of interdisciplinary standing committee on cyber security, that's a very recent thing, and in the monetary policy, sixth bi-monthly policy. So in the latest monetary policy announcement, we said that we'll set up interdisciplinary standing committee on cyber security, because what happens is this is a continuously evolving area, and a lot of new issues come up, a lot of regulatory issues are coming up, and somewhere when we need to react also faster, so there is always a need for a standing committee to address the issues here. So what they would be doing is they'll review the threats inherent in existing emerging technology, and they'll study adoption of various security standards and protocols, and they'll interface with all stakeholders, and they'll suggest appropriate policy interventions to strengthen cybersecurity and resilience. This is very latest. And there is a working group on financial technology. I mean, this is another thing. A lot of banks are going in for blockchain related uses. I think ICICI Bank has gone for this trade finance and all that. And SBI has also, I think frauds, they have gone for blockchain. And there will be more and more applications in using blockchain technology. And also there will be various other, even bitcoins for that matter, and digital currencies, and even some other central banks are thinking in terms of issuing digital currency, like Bank of England and even Federal Reserve. They want to, because it's a very revolutionary concept. Like, what happens if a central bank doesn't issue a currency and it issues only digital currency in the name of all public? That means all the members of public will have account with central bank, and they'll only release currency through in a digital format. I mean, it's a very intriguing concept, and with that, we'll have control over entire money in the system. I mean, now inflation is gentlemen. Monetary policy is, they say it's limited in its effectiveness, because entire bulk of the economy is outside its influence, you know, either black economy or parallel economy, whatever you talk about. If you don't have banks, don't have that money, then we can't influence through monetary policy. So, I mean, these kind of issues, there is a working group set up and drawn from various institutions and all that. They're working on these, and some kind of, as a regulator, we cannot allow things to happen or become a huge issue, or people get cheated or lose money, then only we step in and start regulating. We may have to start studying the subject, understand it first, because without understanding, if you regulate, then it's not going to help anybody. So we need to understand how the market is adapting these new things, then have some kind of generic regulation in place, and let the system, whatever have coming, let it come. And like, for example, we did for peer-to-peer lending, you know, online platforms are there. There are people who are giving you loans at cheaper rates, because it is just like a marriage bureaus, like shaadi.com. I mean, you meet a lender and you are a borrower, you take it. The platform only arranges the forum for meeting them, that's all. they are not intermediary per se. So they will not do financial intermediation. They do just meeting the people. So that has got a lot of issues. So including IT cyber security issues. So we have said that yes, let them come up, and we have some kind of regulation. But once they become very big, that they will start influencing the system, and they are too integrated with the system. Then we may have more issues like licensing and prudential norms and all that. So then finally, we have internally one cyber security lab we are setting up. That will help the inspectors to have better understanding and better skills and tools to do the IT audits of the banks. So finally, the parting thoughts. Cybersecurity is not just an IT issue, it's a business issue. I mean, if somebody thinks that it is still an IT issue, it's only IT department will take care, those days are gone. It is everybody, every banker, if you are talking only about banks, every banker in any department, that is a very important and critical issue. Of course, good risk management is a key. And finally, it is not just the banks also. There are other ecosystem like service providers and so many other people. They are also we need to look at them. And finally, one size doesn't fit all. We need to have, depending on the size and criticality, we have different systems and whatever layer defense or security controls we have, it should be all proportionate. Not necessarily that you have one size and it fits all. And finally, we are in this together. That's the main message I would like to give. It is not some particular section, some particular department's issue. It is everybody's issue. And main thing is collaboration is the key. We can't, supposing we suffer and we don't talk about it, we don't tell people, other banks, then that's not going to help, because unless everybody comes up, like in USA and UK, there is now a lot of improvement in this area, and a lot of collaborative efforts happen. They share, and it really helps, and probably the IBA or somebody should take more initiative here and see that the banks are free, they freely share the incidents, and also there is a platform or forum to share. There is IB card, but again, it needs to really be used more extensively and by reporting and all that. So, and you need to leverage the best practices. So collaboration is the key.